Pete, I guess these days you treat every day as a blessing.
Yeah, pretty much. And that being said, you never know what's going to come. You know, some days are going to be real good. Some days aren't going to be so good. But all in all, every day above the ground is definitely a bonus.
What's a bad day?
A bad day, you wake up and you'll have a headache, you know, and there's no reason, you know, there's nothing you did the day before will cause it. It's just someday you wake up and there it is, and then that day's not going to be good. And when that happens, it affects, that's the days when I really lose balance a lot and lose vision, you know, a lot. It comes and goes quite a bit. Yeah, that's about, you know, there's nothing will give it away the day before, though, just wake up and there it is.
Can I ask you a really tough question?
Mm.
Did you die?
That I don't know. You know, even the last couple of weeks, I learned more and more about things that happened. You know, I spent 2 weeks with Craig and Dominic Selzy here just recently, and you know, things that they knew that I didn't know. You know, it was just quite an odd deal. But I know when the crash happened, I was probably. It took them definitely 5 minutes to find my pulse, and they found it in my ankle. So to me, at that point, they weren't real sure of, you know, how things were rolling anyway. So so whether or not I died, I don't know. And you know, there's so much I don't know. There's weeks that I don't remember, but that's one thing I have no idea how to give you the correct answer on that.
Is that a blessing in some ways that you don't remember too much about the whole thing?
I don't know. You know, I guess it is, but there's so much I want to know.
Is there?
I don't know why, but I just want to know. I need to know. And so, you know, everyone's said stuff about that from when you're, you know, there's a good 6 or 7 weeks that I have no memory of. No memory of changing hospitals, no memory coming home even, no memory of being taught how to have a shower. Just ridiculous things that I have no memory of. I have no memory of the pain that I was in. So
well, that's good.
That's probably a bonus for sure. But for not knowing everything that was going on, I don't know, there's a part in me that wants to know. So
okay. I've looked at the YouTube vision a couple of times that was shot from the grandstand in turn four or coming onto the main straight. Unfortunately, it's not very graphic. It just shows stuff going everywhere. It looked like someone in front of you got a little bit out of shape, a lap car coming out of turn four. And yeah. You sort of ran up on him coming into turn one?
Yeah, Jonathan and I were having a pretty good run, I guess. He started to stretch me out there a little bit there from watching it. And we were lapping this car the second time in 14 laps. So, you know, not saying that he didn't have any business being there, but second time in 14 laps, his speed wasn't right there with everyone else's. And I guess he spun out and come from the bottom of the track and came up, and I was sort of heading on past. So, you know, it was just a racing deal. It wasn't something that anyone planned on happening, so I don't have any blame or anything to put towards, you know, anybody, but it was just a freak deal. It was a one in a million shot, that's for sure. Eventually, you know, we had that big crash with them. Obviously, he come up left rear, right rear, and that unsettled the car pretty well, and it went along the fence, and it finally stopped it going into turn one, and but the nose of the car was pointing towards the infield, and the cage was open to whatever was coming. And a lot of people, you know, a couple of people missed it. And then, unfortunately, a good friend of mine, Jason, he didn't have nowhere to go, and he got right in the cage with me. And the ironic thing was, I have the cage, I have the car at home, and there's no marks on the cage. It just got in at the right angle. Mm. That's all it was, and it bent the top of the seat, and obviously hit me in the head. So, you know, just a freak deal.
How's Jason Statler with all this?
You know,
he's a big, tough man.
He's a big, big boy, and he's a great friend of mine. I wasn't allowed to make phone calls. I wasn't allowed to be on the internet. I wasn't allowed to do, you know, bright lights. I wasn't even allowed to have a can of Coke, let alone a Red Bull. So there were so many things going wrong. But the first time I could make a phone call, he was the person I called. And, you know, he was very emotional and everything, and which he was at the time as well, you know, because he thought he killed me, obviously. Mm. And I called him up just to say thanks for what he did, you know, because he turned the car And if he'd have just continued on straight, you know, that would, you know, there's no way I would be here. But what he did, you know, and I called him up just to tell him thanks. And you know, for, I think obviously it was a hard deal for him. You know, there's so many things that are hard for me, but I think there's so many people that were affected by it, like, and him being one of them, and my family, obviously. But the things that he, you know, I can't imagine thinking that you just killed somebody, that was your mate. So
yeah.
So yeah.
How are you different as a person in your outlook towards things now? If you are different.
Yeah. No, I am different. The biggest thing, I can't put. Think about it for a second, but the nothing's for sure anymore. Like, you know, you go along racing and you think you're invincible and you think nothing's ever going to happen to you, and obviously that's not the case. But that's what I thought all the way along, and that's probably the way you need to think if you're going to drive these cars anyway. You don't need to think that something's going to happen. Mm-hmm. You never think it's going to happen to you, and because if you did, you really have no business being in it. Because if you're a danger to yourself then, or to someone else, that's the whole deal. So I don't think my way of thinking was wrong before, but it's definitely changed the way I am now. It's, you know, you just don't know what's coming, you know. And so I try and, you know, I'm trying to be a better dad and better husband and, you know, just a better friend.
So, I don't think that anyone has a problem with you being a better friend, mate. I mean, when your accident happened, you would have been unaware of the fact that New Zealand and Australia all went into meltdown.
Yeah, no, again, not knowing, you know, when it happened or what was happening, but after it was all, you know, when I started, you know, remembering stuff, it was a big deal. And you know, it doesn't matter who I talk to about, you know, someone, like even just last couple of days, talk to people here, and everyone knows what they were doing. You know, everyone mm-hmm. I was doing, you know, it's like...
And I heard, yep.
It's, so to me, and this is one of the things that I struggle with, I'll never understand how big it actually was.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it doesn't make no sense because, changing subjects just a little bit, just the other day I put on Facebook a picture of Brooke, Tatnall, Skip Jackson and myself, and someone wrote on there, you know, three legends. But I never put myself in the same realm as Brooke and Skip. Like, I always look up to them.
Yeah.
You know, so so have everyone know what they were doing, it was a big thing, you know. So
Definitely. Are you I know you're grateful that you're still here, but are you a bit angry that your career's over? Like that? You never really got a chance to put your own stamp on it.
Yeah, no, I was definitely that way for a long time. Like, I mean, there's so much people don't know what we had to go through to get to where we are. You know, there's some days, some weeks I had seven appointments a week with different doctors. You know, it was just, and I mean different ones, and from brain doctors to, you know, psychiatric doctors. You know, because I was just diagnosed with depression, and because I couldn't race, and it was just a lot of stuff going on there. But so I was mad, but you know, we got to do the, you know, because I was told I couldn't race, so that don't sit well.
Yeah.
So the best deal was we did a couple of laps at Tulare, and they honoured me there, and yeah. I got out and I quit.
Yeah.
Still is a sound, but I quit, not being told what to do, and everything became a lot easier after that point. So.
Well, I mean, Brad Doty did the same thing.
Yeah.
Well, some 10 years later, in Eldora, and that vision, that video still makes me cry every time I see it.
Yeah. Yeah. No, he called me up. Ironically, on the day that I was going, he knew about it, heard about it, and he called me up, and he made things. You know, all the therapists that I had, he was probably the best one, because he knew. There was no second guessing. He'd been through everything. Obviously, to me, his was way worse than mine. But everything that he'd been through was, you know, just a. He understood, so he was very.
Yeah.
He was very good to me. So, it was good.
Because sprint car racing, Peter Murphy's sprint car driver, was probably what defined you, in a lot of ways, wasn't it? And all of a sudden, you had that taken away from you.
Yeah.
So all of a sudden, who's Peter Murphy? Is that a strange question to ask?
No, I ask that question every day. I don't know. I don't have an answer to it. So, It's hard to figure that out, you know, because that's what I did. I raced cars. That's what I raced it, you know, for all my life. This was my life. So yeah. Now I can't do that. So, you know, what do I do now? Got to figure something out.
So what do you do?
You know, obviously hanging here at Parramatta and back at Western Springs, did the commentary stuff. So that's really good, and I really enjoy that. I really like working with people on their cars and that, you know, and even here the last couple of nights here, that's been, you know, a lot of people bounce things off me, and it makes me feel good that they trust me enough that they'll ask me a question, and not that they're looking for my answer to what I do, but my opinion of what they think they're doing, you know, so it works out very well. So I like that.
I think that you have always struggled to give yourself any credit, Pete, because you're very experienced. You're very giving with all of your friends, with your information. And so naturally people are going to look to you to try and work things out. So whilst you're surprised, I'm not. That's, you know, nights like what's coming up on Saturday with your Peter Murphy Appreciation Night, which was Stephen Green's idea, and what Western Springs did and all that sort of stuff, it's a mirror of what you've given to everybody. Yeah. I mean, you think back to what we did with Skip.
Yeah.
Right? So this is just payback. This is coming back at you. You've been paying it forward for years, Murph, so now it's time to cop it back.
Yeah. All I can tell you is it's a very humbling experience to be on this side of it, because, you know, obviously none of this was my intention in my career, was to make it so people would want to do something for me later on. That was never my intention. So, you know, I'm just very fortunate that this is how it's turned out. But, you know, as bad as things have been for me, the fact that people want to, you know, be associated and do something for me is, like I said, it's very humbling as any words I can tell you.
Murph, tell me about the Peter Murphy Classic at Tulare. What are your plans there? What was the whole idea behind that?
Originally, like last year, the deal was I thought I'd ripped everyone off basically by stopping the race, you know. Lap 14, race was done. You know, people, they waited, you know, and people were very, very, very good to me, obviously. But all the drivers, they were in not a good spot, and they all got out of their cars, and, you know, they wanted to go home, and they didn't want to continue. The promotion of the track wanted to continue, but no one wanted to. So it took 50 minutes to get me out of the car. Yep. So it took a long time. But the people waited, and they stayed there forever, and then, you know, they were all there when the helicopter took off. They're all, and it was a very, I was told it was a very eerie place to be when the helicopter took off out of the racetrack. So I felt I owed, you know, something to the people, you know, and it's like what we've talked about, everyone's donated, like over there, they donated money, and people bought t-shirts over here and it donated money, and it was just an amazing thing. And it's obvious, they have the benevolent fund over there in California, which, when you're in trouble, you know, and you can't work or you can't do it, they pay your bills and they look after you very well. And I don't like being in a position to where, you know, there's a I owe people something, you know, so I wanted to pay it back. So we talked about a few things with Brent Cating, and they decided, well, we can put this race on at Tulare, and, you know, and we did it last year. And I raised the purse up enormously, and, well, you know, for their standards there. And then we sold shirts and 50-50 raffles, and I raised, on that one night, $6,600-something, and I gave it back to the benevolent fund, because what they did for me, I wouldn't have, you know, I still wouldn't have a business, I wouldn't have a life, basically, because of them. So they helped it out. So I wanted to give back to that, and that's what we did. And then, because it works so well, then everyone, all the drivers, that let's do it again, you know. And so that's the plan right now, is to make it a bigger and maybe more annual, you know, for quite a while race. So
Saturday, July 25th.
Yep, July 25th. Which will make it, that'll be 2 years and 5 days after the crash at that point. So so we're gonna try and just see what we can do. We had the biggest crowd they've ever had in July. We had the biggest 410 wing car count they've had in 11 years, and we ran non-wings and wing sprint cars, which is if I was racing, I would have run both of them. So it was a good night.
To be fair, you've had exposure to Australian flamboyance and New Zealand flamboyance and how to present a race or a show. I think Americans, with all due respect, a lot of American races they call a show, when in fact they're a race. Whereas now what you're looking at doing is marrying what you know from New Zealand and from Australia into making it a show.
Yeah, no, I'd say that to be true, because the way I looked at it, I wanted it the way I think it should be done, you know, for everybody, and whether it be for the drivers, what I could gain for them, but what I could do for the fans, because you are putting on a show for the people on the hill, and if you can't do something for them, there's no, you know, what's the point of doing it? So we had giveaways for them, and we had, you know...
You had a pole shootout too.
Yeah, we had a pole shuffle, so which is something they've never had in the States before. But you know, recently, you know, we've had it here the last couple of nights, and this is where the first time I ever did it was at Parramatta. So, but the last couple of years in New Zealand, they've had them there, and they've been great races. So, so we did it there the first time ever, and the crowd were very into it, and it was a good deal all around for that for sure. And other things, I'm not. You know, putting them down on that, but I think it becomes a business over there, and they forget about putting on a show. And so I moved the victory podium. I put it in between the grandstand and the track instead of being on the track. And I had first, second, and third. I had huge trophies, and I had Happy Gilmore checks, and I had champagne. So the crowd got wet with the champagne. So that was part of the celebration. So it was just little things that, you know, from here and New Zealand that I brought to America, so it was good. I enjoyed it.
So together with Wayne Meyer, we worked out yesterday that I'm going to take a tour of people that want to come over, and we're going to spend 10 days on Wado's party bus, and we're going to do a bit of that, you know, that little King's Royal race or something first, we're going to roll back over to the West Coast and go to Vegas, and then we're going to head to the Tashi Palace and hang out in a couple of days in your area and see your race and add a bit of Aussie flavour to that, so anyone that wants to get on board can come along and see your race. And we need to have Aussie drivers there too, don't we?
Oh, yeah, no, that's we've talked about having, you know, a couple of Kiwis, or at least a Kiwi and at least an Australian driver there too, so... this year we're starting it a lot earlier, trying to make it all happen. So there's chances that we could do that. I know I also got in trouble by a lot of Australians and Kiwis that we didn't have a live feed from it or something that they could watch. So that's something that I'm trying to make happen as well anyway. But the big bonus would be is to have Australians there in the crowd. You know, and obviously the deal that Wayne Meyer's putting together, you know, especially if you get to come along, you know, it would be just good to have an Australian voice, you know, echoing around, and you know, most of them won't understand probably what you're saying, so...
they understood the ad, didn't they?
Oh, they did, and I've got to say thanks for that last year, because that commercial, you know, it played 20 times on 4 different channels each, you know, 20 times each on each channel, so it was a good thing, and because I am Australian, it just made sense that's what
so you're not a Kiwi. I just want to clarify this.
No, they
because you do run NZ1.
I am, yeah. No, I am. Believe me, I love the Kiwis, and they treat me as I am.
Of course. We'll share your
opinion. Yeah, but they keep bringing up that underarm bowling thing. So, so they don't want to own me, but they don't mind me though.
All right. So Saturday, July 25. We're gonna have details soon of the tour. People have got to get to it. It's at the Tulare Thunder Bowl, where it's going to get scary at Tulare for the second annual Peter Murphy Classic.
Yes, that sounds about right.
What would Mike Raymond say?
Be there.